Hello, good morning students, and welcome back once again to another video for the 10th standard, that is magnetic effects of electric current. And we'll continue with the exercise with some more questions. When is the force on a current carrying conductor maximum? So when a conductor is placed in a magnetic field, it will experience force, we know that. So when will that force be the maximum amount, that it will experience the maximum force? So the maximum force when the conductor will experience is at an angle of 90 degree. So suppose this is a magnetic field, and if the current is placed 90 degree to it, then it will experience the maximum force. If it is placed parallel, it will not experience force, but if it is placed at 90 degree, it will experience maximum force. Okay, now this one is a complicated one. Imagine you are sitting against a wall. So imagine the wall is over here and I am sitting like this. An electron beam moving from back of the wall to the front wall. So electron from back of the wall is moving towards the front wall. So the electron is moving this way. Okay. Next part. It is deflected by a strong magnetic field to your right. It is deflected by a strong magnetic field. So the electron was moving this way, but now its direction has been this way, because electron is moving this way in a magnetic field. Therefore, it will get a deflection in this direction. That is what the question is. And the next part of the question is, in which direction is the magnetic field? So you are supposed to find the direction of magnetic field. Okay, I haven't written the whole question. Okay, otherwise it will be difficult for you to see on the board. That is why. So from the back side of the ball to the front side, the electron is moving and it is getting deflected to your right. Okay. So in which direction is the magnetic field? So obviously you are going to use the Fleming's left hand rule, and in that we know that we have to keep the two fingers and a thumb 90 degree to each other, like this. Okay, as you can see, the thumb and the second finger at 90 degree, first finger and the second finger also 90 degree, and if you watch this way, once again the thumb and the first finger is at 90 degree. So all the three of this are supposed to keep at 90 degree to find the direction of magnetic field. Now you have to remember that the second finger shows the direction of current. First finger shows the direction of magnetic field, and thumb shows the direction of the motion or the force. So let's proceed with the Fleming's left hand rule. This is the ball, electron moving in this direction. So obviously the direction should be the thumb. So we will keep the direction like this. But if you remember, in the electricity chapter, we have studied that the current in the circuit is in the opposite direction to the flow of negative charges. So if the electron is moving this way, then the current is moving in the opposite direction. I repeat once again, the direction of current is in the opposite direction of the negative charges. So if the negative charged electron is moving that way, that means the current is in the opposite direction. So the direction of the current is in this way. Okay? But it is said that the direction of the electron is this way. So the deflection of the electron is this way. So my first finger, which shows the direction of magnetic field, is in the downward direction. And hence, the direction of the magnetic field is in the downward direction. Okay? I hope it is clear to you, friends. Once again, the direction of the electron is shown by the thumb, which is in the right side, and the second finger shows the direction of the current, which is in the opposite direction, that is this way. Electron is moving this way, that is why current is in this direction. So my first finger shows the downward direction, which is the direction of magnetic field. And that is how you are supposed to find using the Fleming's left hand rule. I hope it is clear, students. Next question. Draw a level diagram of electric motor, which is in the textbook, okay, and write its principle and working. So you are supposed to write its principle and working. Working, once again, I have provided you with the notes, or you can use the textbook as well. It's fine, you can write the working. But the principle, let's recite the principle once again. So the principle is simple, that when a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. This is what the principle is for the electric motor. I repeat once again, when a conductor which is carrying current is placed in a magnetic field, it will experience force. That means means it will move according to the Fleming's left hand rule in a particular direction, wherever the magnetic field is, what is the direction of the current, according to that it will move in a particular direction. Okay, similarly for the last question, name some devices which use electric motor. So the devices which use electric motor nowadays, electric motor is very common. We use in fans, we use in refrigerators, ACs, washing machines, even your mobile phones which has vibration motor inside, that is also the same thing. Okay, your small toy cars all use electric motors. Okay, so devices which use electric motor is fans, washing machines, refrigerators and ACs. You can write this, it's enough. Okay students, so the next question is, a coil of a copper wire is connected to a galvanometer. What will happen if magnet is pushed in the coil? So this is the experiment of the Michael Faraday that we studied during the chapter, that there is a coil and when a magnet is pushed inside it, what happens? That we will get a deflection in galvanometer according to the direction of the magnet that you are pushing, that is either from this side or this side, you will see a deflection in the galvanometer, which suggests that the current is induced in the coil, because galvanometer shows us the potential difference generated. Okay, so when a magnet is pushed inside a coil, you will see a deflection in the needle of a galvanometer. Second question, if the magnet is withdrawn from the coil, so whichever magnet that you pushed inside the coil, now you are taking it out. So when you are removing the magnet, once again the magnetic field is moving along with the magnet around the coil. That means once again you will see the deflection in the galvanometer, but now because the magnet is moving in the other direction, that means the magnetic field is also moving in the other direction. So the deflection on the coil will be in opposite direction. So the galvanometer will show the deflection, but it will be in the opposite direction, which means the current is generated, but in the opposite direction than before. Okay, so the same thing as the one before, when the magnet is pushed inside, the galvanometer will show the deflection, but when you are pulling out the magnet, at that time the galvanometer will show the deflection, but in opposite direction. Now the third one, what will happen if the magnet is held stationary inside the coil? If the magnet is held stationary, that means you are just keeping the magnet inside the coil, then what will happen? Well, nothing will happen because the magnet is not moving. The current is only induced when the magnetic field is changing continuously or around the coil. So in this case, when you are placing the magnet inside the coil, at that time the magnetic field is not changing, it is not moving. That means the galvanometer will show no deflection. It will show no deflection. Okay? Moving on to the next question. Two stationary coils A and B are placed close to each other. If current is passed in coil A, will some current be induced in coil B? Give reason. So yes, we know this. We talked about this in the chapter, that is induction of the current, that electromagnetic induction. Two coils are placed next to each other. When current is passed in coil A, then coil B will also get a small deflection in the galvanometer. So the answer is yes. The small amount of current will be induced on coil B. So the answer is yes. But the reason is that when you're passing the current in coil B or coil A, so what happens is because of this, a small amount of magnetic field is changing around the coil B as well. And because of that small change in coil B, small amount of current is generated for a second. Okay? I hope it is clear to you students. The reason is because the coil A is inducing magnetic field, and that is changing around coil B for a little bit. Because of that change, small current will be generated for a moment in coil B. Okay? This is the reason, because of the changing magnetic field. Now the next question. State the rule to determine the direction. So you need to state which rule and explain them. So I have already given the notes as well, as you can find them in the textbook as well. So first you need to understand which rule is for which one. So first one is magnetic field around a straight conductor. So this is the very first thing that we studied. For a straight conductor, the magnetic field is in a circular form. Okay, and for that we have Maxwell's right hand thumb rule. Okay, Maxwell's right hand thumb rule, that the fingers will show you the circular field lines around the conductor. Straight state conductor carrying current placed in a magnetic field. So this is just the thing that we studied when we studied electric motor right now in the previous question. So state conductor carrying current placed in a magnetic field experiencing force, Fleming's left hand rule. Okay, in which direction the force will be generated using the Fleming's left hand rule? That is, the thumb will show you the direction of the motion or the force. The last one, current induced in the coil due to rotation of the coil. So this is the exact opposite of the Fleming's left hand rule, that is Fleming's right hand rule, for which the second finger shows us the direction of induced current. First finger is 1 second magnetic field, the thumb shows the direction of motion in which you are providing the motion. Okay, and the second finger shows the direction of the current induced. I hope it is clear to you students, and let's move forward to the next questions. Okay students, so the last three questions of the exercise, let's finish them. Explain the principle and working of electric generator. So the electric generator works on the principle of electromagnetic induction. Electric motor works on the principle of electromagnetic induction. Okay, remember that. The principle of electric motor and electric generator is different. Electric motor works on the principle that when a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences force. And the principle of electric generator is electromagnetic induction. Okay? And the next part is draw a label diagram. You can use the textbook and draw the label diagram in your notebooks. And what is the function of brushes? So when you observe the diagram, you will see that the brushes are actually the small black connection which is connected to the slip rings or the split rings. The brushes are used both in electric motors and generators because they provide the flow of current. They are completing the circuit. They are connected to the slip rings of the generator. So when the current is induced, the rings which are connected to the brushes, and brushes are connected to the external circuit where you can provide it with the load. Okay, so brushes provide the connection of the slip rings to the circuit. I hope it is clear. Once again I repeated, the brushes provide the connection of the rings from the electric motor to the electric circuit. Okay, okay, next part is, when does short circuit occur? So short circuiting occurs when the live wire and the neutral wire comes in contact with each other, because of which a huge amount of current abruptly increases in the circuit and therefore it causes short circuiting. This we have discussed in the electricity chapter during exercise and explanation. We also discussed the same topic once again in this chapter. Okay, so it is quite common now. And the last one, what is the function of earth wire? So the earthing wire or the earth wire is used to protect ourselves and the people using the appliances so that they do not get a severe electric shock. Because if there is a leakage of the current on an appliance, then the whole body of the appliance might be able for an electric shock because the current is leaking. So what is happening is the earth wire is connected to the body part of the appliance and then it goes down to the earthing of our house, which causes the extra potential that is leaking on the body gets transferred to the earth. Okay, and that is why it is a sort of safety measure taken for us such that we do not get a severe electric shock. So that we do not get a severe electric shock. Now, this were the last questions of the exercise, and that concludes us. From the next video onwards, we will start with a new chapter. Okay, till then, have a nice day.